Rev up your engines!
General Motors appears to have lost their minds. They're going to make a heavy-duty Silverado pickup truck that will be the first pickup truck in the United States to have a list price of over $100,000. I'm not talking about a house here. I'm talking about a pickup truck. I swear, people are losing their minds. General Motors is actually bragging about this, you know? People want higher trim and more stuff is what their image was on that. I don't know what planet these people live on, but $100,000 pickup. They do start selling those things out. Well, let me tell you, I'm going to be the last guy to buy one. Jessica, 1981. Scotty, thanks for all the great vids. Can a manual transmission new V8 Mustang last longer than automatic? All right. Actually, on that, the automatic is a better one to get. It's that 10-speed automatic that Ford and Chevy had a joint deal with, and then they, when they were done, they fell apart because Ford didn't like what Chevy did. A lot of them are made in China, and they've had quality control problems with them. I had a customer with one, went through four of them, and when the fourth one broke, they just gave the car back and said, I don't want it anymore. These transmissions are junk, so I would go with automatic on those. If you find out it's got a Chinese-made standard transmission, I personally would not buy it. Little tiny friend, I know you said Nissan doesn't make good cars anymore, but what do you think about the 2018 Nissan Titan? They've always made decent engines in the Titans. Either had their V8 or some of them now have the Cummins engine in it, which is an excellent engine. But still, for the money that you're going to be paying, you're better off getting an F-150 if you want a full-size truck, or if you don't mind the extra money, getting a Toyota Tundra, which costs a bit more and lasts a bit longer. But I still wouldn't buy the Nissan pickup. It's not for the money. Yeah, you're not really getting your money's worth or the time. Carex says, Scotty, what do you think of a Ford Focus ST around year 2015? Got to be a reliable, fun daily driver. Depends on the mileage. The Fusions are pretty good cars. The Focuses, they're a lot cheaper made car. Now, I've had customers with them that got good, reliable age out of them, but once they got 120,000-130,000 miles, they started falling apart. The trannies broke, all the plastic crap, and the engine started cracking and breaking. But if it's a 2015 and it's got lower mileage, if you can get it cheap enough, it could be a reliable car for a while. Just don't expect it to last like a Honda or a Toyota and go 200,000-400,000 miles. It's not going to do that. But if you can get one cheap enough that's got low enough mileage, it still could be a decent knock-around car. The Asian Man, is a 2015 Q50 Infiniti a money pit with 28,000 miles? No, not yet. I got customers with them that love them when they buy them new and keep them for a while. They generally don't start falling apart till they get over 100,000 miles in them. Then, yes, they are money pits, but it's only 5 years old and it's got 28,000 miles. It's still got a lot of life. But that said, if you're talking about buying one, pay less. It's a used car. It's 5 years old. Take advantage of that. It could be a fun car to drive around in, but don't pay too much for it because they are problems as they age. The Infiniti parts are expensive. They're harder to work on. And Infiniti's just a fancy Nissan, and the Nissan quality isn't what it used to be. Tim Lawson 100 says, Scotty, my brakes pulse at highway speeds, but not in town. Yeah, it means that your brake rotors are warped. You step on the brakes, and then it starts to warp. And it starts shaking because it's going like this, but only a few thousandths of an inch. But I'm exaggerating. But then it makes either the steering wheel pulse because it's the front ones, or if it's the pedal that pulses, then it's the back ones, because the back ones don't make your steering wheel shake, but they'll make the brake pedal pulse up and down. You change both the rotors and the pads, though, because if the rotors are worn, so are the pads, and you change them as a set. Zally D94, Scotty, I got an 06 Audi A4 with a 2.0T FSI. Should I use regular or full synthetic oil? Use full synthetic oil. The German cars are all made for full synthetic oil. They got so many tricky parts. You want to keep lubrication as good as possible, and my advice is buy a good one like Redline or Castrol and stick to one brand, because there are slight differences in the additives on it, and your engine gets used to one set of additives. Stick to it, don't keep switching them around, but use full synthetic. Danaboo, the power seats in my Hyundai Sonata 2013. 2 days ago, I reclined the seat and it's stuck. I can't get it back. I got a pillow in there. Help. You got a problem with that power motor system. They are a bear to work on. Sometimes you got to take the seat out. Sometimes you got to take the upholstery apart. It is a pain in the butt. So what you want to do is get a friend in there. And while one of you is trying to make it go wiggle that stupid switch and pull and pull. And if you can finally get it to go back in one position, leave it in that position and don't mess with it anymore. That thing is what? It's 7 years old. If it really is broken, sometimes you're cheaper just going to a junkyard and buying the whole seat with the motor in it. And then just there's only four bolts holding the seat and taking it out and bolting the whole thing in. So electric motor stuff, super expensive, and it's not that easy to work on. The Kurt, I have an 01 Toyota Sequoia, lost the key to it. The dealership wants a small fortune. Help. Everything is so complicated nowadays with that stuff, with all these anti-theft and keys that have chips in them, and then ones that don't even have keys that are using the RFI signal to get to it to start the car. They can be really complicated. But, at least here in the big city of Houston, and from what other people tell me around the world, there are many excellent locksmiths out there that now get into this work. In Houston, I know this Pakistani guy and his wife. He's real nice. He makes house calls to people's houses for like 70 bucks. He generally can make keys, reprogram stuff. He's got it all set up for that. So look for a locksmith that does that kind of stuff. Now, I personally have equipment to do it. This $5,000 Scantle I have does that. But for a lot of cars, I can't because I'm not a bonded locksmith and I'm not a dealer mechanic. And for a lot of that stuff, the only people that can get the codes to actually reprogram them are bonded locksmiths and guys who work at the dealership. So I know how to do it, but I can't because I can't get the code. So try a good bonded locksmith. Dusty Mag, can a car get sufficient oil when it drives uphill on a steep slope? Oh, of course. The oil pans are designed, most of them have various baffle plates so that they don't scavenge and suck air. And they got enough oil in it that the sump is low enough and it's inside a baffle so that it doesn't get air in it and suck air and then burn the engine out. That, by the way, was one of the problems with those Toyota Celicas, the ones that had the Yamaha designed engine, was that they didn't build the oil pan right. And when they cornered really hard, the oil would go to the side and they would suck air and then the engines blew up because the bearings would run dry. So it's a very good question, but most cars can do it fine because they're designed for that. Bailey Hatfield, Scotty, I got an 06 Dodge Charger Daytona with a 5.7 Hemi. I've never had AC since I got it. What should I do? All right, air conditioning systems, they hate water. There's a lot of water vapor in our atmosphere. If that system is open to the air, the whole thing's probably useless and all corroded inside. Now, if it doesn't have any gigantic leaks, I would say have it evacuated for an hour. That gets rid of the moisture. Fill it up and see what happens. Now, if you hear it hissing and it leaks out, you got to fix the leak. But then you're going to realize that if it did all leak out entirely, that means air probably got in and the air has moisture and then everything's rusted inside and you might have to spend a fortune doing the whole system over. But hey, pray evacuate it and put some in. At least gets it working for a while and see what happens. It's a problem with air conditioning systems. I had a friend who was a really good mechanic and he had a piece of paper, a legal document. He made them all sign when he did AC work that says, AC work, you never know what's wrong until it's fixed. I can work on your car and fix some things and then find out a month later that there's another problem down the line. So I'm warning you that this estimate is only an estimate. It could need a lot more work. And he made everybody who did AC work sign it. He was an honest guy. But he just got sick of people whining that, oh, well, you didn't fix it right. And he didn't want to be a crook and say, well, you got to replace everything and it's going to be $3,500. So he would warn them about them. It can be a real pain fixing them when they finally break on an older car. And that's 14 years old. Fred Anderson and Fred said, Scotty, Harbor Freight Tools just rolled out a knockout version of the fancy scan tool you use to diagnose car problems. What do you think of it? Okay, well, basically, they're using, it seems to me, the same company that's making those things. I believe it's Autel. They made the old Autel Moxie DOS, and they used to sell the Autel Moxie DOS at Harbor Freight Tools. Now, it seems that they're selling the upgraded version a little bit more money. And yes, they're good scan tools. You know, I personally have one. And I use it. It's a good scan tool. You're spending, you know, a lot of money. They're not cheap tools, but they're pretty good tools. So if you never want to miss another one of my new car repair videos, remember to ring that bell.